Dr. Richard Shapcott is the senior lecturer in international relations at the University of Queensland. His areas of interest in research concern international ethics, cosmopolitan political theory, and cultural diversity. He is the author of the recently published book titled International Ethics, A Critical Introduction, and several other pieces such as Anti-Cosmopolitanism, The Cosmopolitan Harm Principle, and Global Dialogue, in Michaelis and Petito's book, Civilizational Dialogue and World Order. He is also the author of Dialogue and International Ethics, Religion, Cultural Diversity, and Universalism, in Patrick Hayden's The Ashgate Research Companion to Ethics and International Relations. This interview will discuss the role of democracy in political, cosmopolitan ethics. It was recorded during a lunch at the Customs House in Brisbane, a historically significant heritage building with pleasing stone facades and a grand view of the Brisbane River. Due to this interview having been conducted in a public setting, there are atmospheric noises which are present. We hope that these add to the experience rather than detract from the quality of our discussion. The purpose of this interview is to explore the international ethics concerning a new theory of democracy. To help inform the answers provided by Dr. Richard Shapcott of the University of Queensland, who is the author of many works, including the recently published International Ethics, A Critical Introduction, are several questions derived from his work concerning moral relativism and the concept of a nation. Richard, welcome. Thank you for coming down.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting me.
Right. We'll start with the first question. Given the attention paid to moral pluralism in international ethics, would you argue that there are certain rudimentary human universals, in the words of Donald D. Brown, that can be identified to help shape international projects?
Yes and no, is I guess my answer to that one. I'm not exactly sure how Donald Brown means that, but it's very clear that there are certain basic physical universals for human beings. We need, in order to survive, we need food and shelter and a fair bit of sort of social interaction and those sorts of things. So they're fairly clear physical universals that human body requires, as any other animal requires, and there's enough to think that our psyche requires social interaction, and you know, no man is an island, and we so having a community of some sort, whether it be a family or a wider community, is an important part of who we are. So if we're talking about human universals in terms of things that characterize us all as human beings, that's certainly the case. Beyond that, if we're talking about universals that we all might agree upon, that's another question. And I hold out the hope that we may be, or that we are in principle capable of agreeing on some things. That's still an open question. So I would certainly not go so far as saying there are already identified areas of moral agreement. I think that's always too easy to assume.
Right. So, if we did assume that there are these areas of sort of moral ethics that could be, or that are universal to humanity, how could we identify those? Is there sort of, do we have to depend on heuristic methods, or could we approach this question through empirical devices, and or is that beyond the mere capacities of one person?
I think my view on this is not that it's not a matter of identifying pre-existing ones, it's a matter of working towards making new ones or making shared agreements. Ethics and values are, I see them as socially constructed, in the jargon. That is, that they're the product of human beings' minds and facility for language. And therefore, any universals we want to endorse, we would need to, in a sense, create them. There's a nice quote that Chris Brown uses from Richard Rorty about ethics being and communities being shaped rather than found. And I think that's a nice way to think about it, that we are in a position where we have an ongoing challenge to shape these universals rather than to identify them. But that doesn't mean we can't, of course, engage in dialogue with everybody, so to speak, to seek to understand where we are. That's the first stage. So rather than sort of empirically identifying basic shared norms, the real question is how we interpret those norms, and how, in order to identify what people believe, we need to engage in dialogue with each other about this. And so there's a great deal of merit that's actually necessary to engage in dialogue with different ethical, moral traditions and communities in order to understand each other. And that's the basis, as I see, of any genuine sort of moral universalism we may create. We may identify things that we have in common. We may identify the ways in which we interpret common things differently. And then we have to ask the question, can we build something new? Can we come to share some new understandings?
Excellent. Would you argue that there is a balance between general laws and the relative context they're being observed in? Should this always inform our efforts to help outsiders or even compatriots?
Well, a concept that appeals to me very much is the Aristotelian concept of phronesis, which is employed by Hans-Georg Gadamer in his account of philosophical hermeneutics, which I draw upon a lot. And that's the Aristotle's claim and Gadamer's claim is that in ethical thinking, that's what we are always doing, is the back and forward between universal ideas, universal general principles, and specific instances and circumstances. So in that sense, I think that's the essence of ethical reasoning, and that applies to all instances of it, or rather, that's the most desirable way to think about what we're doing, rather than to simply derive empirical rules or universal rules that we then simply apply to all cases. That we need to constantly be aware of context and how context transforms and feeds back, if you like, on the universal. So in that sense, that question speaks to that, my understanding of that concept of the phronesis.
Let's move on to focusing more on sort of cosmopolitanism, I suppose. How can anti-cosmopolitans maintain the theory of a nation when that concept is increasingly more difficult to define, specifically due to the effects of modern migration and the diversification of citizenry?
Well, I think they try to, not all anti-cosmopolitans wedded to the idea of nationhood. Some have other accounts of allegiance and community. I think it's a very important question. Yeah, I get it. As always, for us academics, it depends on what you mean by the nation. My sense is that they can do it partly because that's the language and the belief system that most of the world continues to operate in. Of course, there are many. It's much more problematic than it used to be. There are a lot of other claims to subnational identity or a lot more fractured national identity, but many people still continue to live and work, understand themselves as being members of nations, and that's a very powerful idea that despite migration and globalization continues to hold quite a powerful grip on human imagination about political community. So while it is being more fractioned, it's still there. So that's the first part of the answer, is that they can do that because it's how people live their lives. And this becomes clearer when you start to ask questions about how should we treat outsiders. That's when those distinctions really come up. That people start to make that distinction, and that's where the ethical content of nationalism becomes emergent. I think, on the other hand, that they can also, that the part of the national anti-cosmopolitan claim is, of course, not simply an empirical claim about what people do, but also because about how we ought to live. And in that case, they've got a perfectly reasonable case to say, well, the nation has performed a useful role in giving people a strong sense of identity and belonging in a world of conflict and change and those sorts of things. So there's a normative claim in defence of the nation in one form or another that has quite a lot of merit to it. I mean, the problem for me that comes up is not so much the contemporary transformations of political life. We in Australia are lucky in many ways to live in a country that is what we call settler society, and we're not as beholden by history when it comes to our conception of our identity. So Australia, the United States, Canada, places like this have a tradition of incorporating new arrivals in them all the time. It's sometimes contested and sometimes not so friendly and a bit more selective and whatnot, but there is that sense that we don't have that ethnic conception of the nation in the same way that, older European societies may have. And that provides us with a capacity to reimagine our nation along different lines. But the really interesting thing for me about anti-cosmopolitanism and their conception of the nation is many of them, I'm thinking, for instance, of someone like David Miller, who doesn't seem to incorporate the historical theories of nationalism, of how it is we come to live in nations. They take the nation for granted as some sort of political community. Because they want to defend it, they want to defend certain achievements of it. And I think that's problematic for them, because if we understand the nation is an historically formed community, and 1,000 years ago nobody lived in nations as we understand them, then that raises the question about the future of the nation and its defensibility, and asks us to at least examine the possibility that nations are changing and may become something else.
We're going to be just going on now, sort of discussing democracy, cosmopolitanism, and so on, and this idea of sort of a basic democracy, which ties into questions asked before about sort of these basic, universal parameters for all humanity, something tied in perhaps to the id, to those social formations that you spoke of earlier. But before we do that, it's quite important for us to know how you conceptualize democracy.
I conceptualize democracy. I guess I haven't given a lot of thought to democracy per se. My thinking's mostly been concerned with dialogue and cosmopolitanism. So I guess insofar as I think about it's the dialogical aspects of democracy that I think are the ethically important ones. Democracy serves many functions in society. It's a way of resolving interests, conflicts of interests, and allowing and managing complex societies to work through issues. And I guess from my perspective, I like to think of democracy as being the chief